So there is one central block box which is seen, sir. Oh, and on top also there is a small box.
Okay, you want me to move it?
Okay, sir. I think it's above the slide only. We can leave it like that, sir.
Okay. I'll just see if I can move my slide. Okay, good.
So again, the box is in centrally, sir. Oh, yes, sir. So we welcome you all for the last master class in glaucoma. So today's talk would be by Dr. Ganesh sir from Coimbatore on medical management of glaucoma and novel glaucoma therapy. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Annamalai. I thank R.K. sir, Venkatesh sir, and Prajna sir for arranging this master class. I'll be speaking to you on medical management of glaucoma and novel glaucoma therapies. So you all may recollect the principles of treating glaucoma. So that is, number one is to preserve the vision. Number two is to preserve the quality of life. And number three, which has come in the fourth European Glaucoma Guidelines, is cost containment. And all these goals are achieved by preventing the progression by maintaining IOP, at which further damage is arrested. So that is something which we have to understand. So preserve the vision, preserve the quality of life, and also do it at a cost which is affordable by the patient. So IOP control in glaucoma management has been elicited many population-based studies. The incidence, severity, and progression of glaucoma consistently correlate with the elevated IOP. So if the IOP is low, progression doesn't happen, and severity of the glaucoma is also it can be arrested. IOP reduction is currently the only treatment available for decreasing the risk of the disease progression. And you must understand that the individual patient's IOP affects the treatment decisions. That means all other factors, bioavailability, compliance, everything comes into play. And whatever IOP reading which you're getting, you must understand that fluctuations can occur. So just because you saw 17 or 18 doesn't mean it's 17 and 18. It could be plus minus 2 or 3 points here and there. It's just a chance that you got whatever reading you got. So I would suggest all of you go through this EGS recommendations. And it's a very good book. The fourth edition is freely downloadable. The fifth edition has just come out. And whom do we treat? Now, for example, if you look at this chart, patient who comes to us with a normal, near normal vision, and he doesn't have the disease, goes throughout life without ever experiencing any disability. Okay. Now, some patients may come to us at this stage of B. So they may also have reduced vision, progressive, but they never have a functional impairment, severe functional impairment. They may lose some vision, but our duty is to make it so that they never have a severe functional visual impairment. Some patients come to us as C, that is, they already have lost some vision, and then we have started treating them, then they disappear, then they take treatment elsewhere, and then they come back to us again, and then you find that they come to a stage where severe functional impairment is there, and then we have to do whatever we can to salvage the vision. Some people come to us as D. So they start off with very low vision to begin with, and then they rapidly progress. So many of our free patients, many of our paying patients, they come to us at position D. They already are 0.8 cupping, 0.9 cupping, and then we have to treat them such a manner that they never experience a severe functional impairment. Some people are very rapid progressors. For example, number F. They start off with some loss, and then immediately, within a very short span of time, they lose their vision. And some people are extremely rapid progressors. They may come with normal vision, and maybe 2 or 3 years down the line, you find that they are lost. So this is something like a angle closure glaucoma or pseudo exfoliation with secondary angle closure. These patients come to us. We say everything's okay for you. Then you can go home. Within 4 years, they come back, they find that that's 0.8, 0.9 cupping. So what our duty is to treat people who are having severe functional impairment and make sure that their optic nerve outlives their life. That is the aim of the glaucoma treatment. So why are medications the first choice? There are a lot of merits as well as demerits. First is they are very well tolerated. They are suited for alteration. That is, you can switch off one and restart another one. There are numerous agents to choose from. And acute complications are little rare. You can always change to laser or surgery. Demerits are that compared to surgery, they are less effective in lowering IOP. With surgery, you can achieve IOP of 12, 13, 14, but medication, you may not bring it down to lower than 16 millimeters. And you always have a tendency to escalate the treatment with time. It interferes with the success of filtering surgery later on. Potentially, there are serious side effects which can occur, and potentially cross reaction with systemic medication can also occur. It affects the quality of life because the patient thinks of this as a nuisance value. He has to put drops. If he misses it, he feels guilty. If he uses it, he doesn't know the reward. And long-term cost may be very high. Compliance is a totally different, very important issue, and it totally affects the way in which the patients, in which we see our patients and how we treat the patients. So compliance is usually very poor if you are using medication, unlike laser or surgery. So step-by-step is making it, to take a decision to treat. So you have to consider like age, gender, occupation, diagnosis, laterality, stage, severity of the glaucoma, rate of progression, follow-up comorbid conditions. What is the first line therapy you want to use? What is a choice, first choice therapy which you like to use? There's a difference between the two. I'll come to that shortly. What other medications are available? Can you use other therapies? For example, a pregnant lady, can you use SLT therapy? Is it beneficial for her? And primary surgery, we offer this to many of our free patients, CAM patients. Primary surgery, we just ask them to use drops for a few days and then come back to we do the surgery. So all these have to be considered before making a decision to treat. When you start treatment, you have to think of the treatment target. At what level will you stop or stop escalating the treatment? So that is something different from target IOP. Okay, and what are the available therapies, like I mentioned, SLT and surgery, and what is other IOP lowering capacity available options? All these things will go into your mind when you want to start treating the patient. So the most important thing is treatment target. So coming to the target IOP, it has based on the pressure reduction required to slow or retard the disease progression. Target IOP needs to be individualized, and benefits of further pressure reduction need to be weighed against the risk. When the target is achieved, the patient needs to be continued for monitoring for structural and functional change. That is, you have to do the visual fields and the structural assessment. That is, fundus photography if you are doing regularly, or OCT if you are doing regularly, you have to continue to do it to assess progression. Target IOP has been defined by the American Academy to achieve a 20% reduction in mild glaucomas, in which optic nerve changes and visual fields are normal. In moderate glaucoma, in which visual field loss within one hemifield but not within 5 degrees of fixation is there, you achieve you try to achieve a target IOP of 30% reduction from the baseline IOP levels. And in severe glaucoma, in which field loss is there in both hemifield or fixation loss within 5 degrees of fixation, you try to achieve a reduction of IOP of 35% to 40% from the baseline. So this is not arbitrary. This has been given to us by many studies over the many years. For example, the OATS and the EMGT study, in which they achieved 20 and 25% reduction respectively. They had a very low rate of progression in those treated patients. So once they achieved that 20, 25% reduction, mind you, this is a study in which one arm was treated, the other arm was not treated. So nowadays, because of ethical consideration, we cannot do such a study, but it was done at that time. So they achieved, once you achieve the target IOP, progression was reduced. Similarly, for normal tension glaucoma patients, you achieve a 30% reduction, then there was only 12% progression compared to 35% progression over a period of 7 years. So similarly, other studies also, if you are using medication first and you achieve a target IOP of, let's say, 40% reduction, there was no progression. If you are surgery first and you achieve a target IOP of 50% reduction, there was no progression. So this has all been given to us by from the guidelines of the American Academy, and also from the lot of landmark glaucoma trials which have happened in the past. So whenever you are going to start the treatment, you have to know the patient characteristics and the drug properties. So patient characteristics will include the clinical picture, whether the patient has angle closure or not, other features, pseudoexposition, what is the safety profile, ocular as well as systemic, how is he going to adhere to your instructions, is the treatment which you are going to give going to affect his quality of life. Then the second comes the drug properties. What is the mechanism of action? Can you wait for 3 or 4 weeks for the pressure to reduce, or do you want the pressure to reduce tomorrow itself? So the mechanism of action you have to know. How efficacious is the drug going to be? Are you going to achieve the target IP with a single medicine, or are you already planning to start another medicine once the patient comes back to you? How is the ocular surface? Can you use a BAK containing drop, or can you use a preservative containing drop, or must you go preservative free? And if you write the prescription, can the patient go to the pharmacy and buy the medication? So patient characteristics and drug properties will help you to identify the first choice treatment. Now, first choice is something which is chosen on the medical grounds by the treating physician. That is something called the first choice or drug of choice. That's what we say. But what we practice is the first line, because all the factors which we enumerated previously, especially related to cost, is very important. Some other countries have administrative and legislative reasons. For example, Australia, you cannot write a prostaglandin without writing a non-prostaglandin first. Even in the US, when the latanoprost molecule was launched, they could not write latanoprost without trying a non-latanoprost medication first. So because of legislation or some administrative reasons, you may have to shift to a first-line therapy. First-line therapy is also very important for us, because we have been having pilocarpine and timolol for many years with us, and we are familiar with the product. So angle closure, or for example, pseudophakic glaucoma, we'll never almost operate a patient without trying a bout of treatment with pilocarpine. So because we are familiar with the product, it's always been with us almost 40, 50 years. So without trying that, we may not be going to escalate the treatment. So first line treatment is all these factors taken into consideration. But once you have decided what you are going to start with, you have to see whether that molecule has any systemic contraindications. Then what are the ocular characteristics, as I mentioned before? How is the ocular surface? Should you consider preservative-free options? What other concomitant eye disease he has? For example, with respect to cornea, etc. And then you decide what medication you want to choose. So general guidelines are that the most appropriate medication has to be chosen, which has the greatest chance of attaining the target IOP. Best safety profile, minimally inconvenient and affordable. So cost is always an important factor which you should understand, and also minimally inconvenient. You should always start low and slow. That is the minimal concentration and minimal frequency. Then you can escalate. Patient-related factors, you have to encourage the patient to close his lids, close the eyes, and also help him, teach him to do punctal occlusion. Always encourage them to apply drops with at least 5 minutes gap between the drops. 10 minutes is better, minimum 5 minutes, because each drop will dilute the other one and nothing will penetrate the eye. And all these factors you have to explain to them so that they understand why they are doing it. Otherwise, it will just become like a ritual, and after some time, they won't know the logic behind it, and then they'll abandon doing it. Educate the patients to enhance the compliance. And whenever you feel that suboptimal therapy is there, you always try to substitute rather than add to the therapy whenever it is inadequate. So this is one of the flow charts which you can follow. So whatever you are starting, whether it is prostaglandin, beta blocker, alpha agonist or pilocarpine, you see whether it is tolerated and effective on the IOP. If the target IOP is achieved, then periodically verify all these four endpoints. That is, visual field should not progress, optic disc should not deteriorate, IOP should be low, and the quality of life of the patient should not be changed. If the effect is not there, target IOP is not reached, switch to another therapy or consider laser procedure. If you have suboptimal response, that is, you are expecting about 6 millimeter drop, but you get only 4 millimeter drop, then you can consider adding one more medication. Target IOP is not reached, then substitute the second drug and verify efficacy, or try other options. If you are starting a medication, it is not tolerated or not effective on the IOP, then switch to monotherapy or consider laser. This graph is even much better. You can see that you have maximum adherence of the patient. It reaches the target IOP. Yes, continue treatment and monitor. Monitoring, I told you previous slide, check the IOP, check the visual field, check the optic disc and assess the quality of life of the patient. If it has not reached the target IOP, but you have partial effect or you have side effect, stop it and hold it in reserve. Start the second medication. Okay, and then it goes on till you have chosen two or three more medications in this manner. So compliance, coming to compliance, you must understand that 20% of the patients are partially or totally dependent on others for applying the eye drops. Identifying non-compliant patients is very, very difficult. All the patient will come and say that they are applying drops 100% of the time. Oh, always overestimate compliance by 10%. Many patients use drops just prior to their visits. So the fact is, most patients miss some drops, some miss most drops, few miss all the drops. This is taught to us by Dr. Alan Robin, who is our mentor. What is the effect of compliance? There is reduced bioavailability at the target sites. And this is the most common cause affecting the bioavailability of the drug at the target sites. And there's an assumption that there is no effect, that is the medication is not working, so change the medication. What happens is, for every time this happens, you keep changing the medication. So there is additional medication which is prescribed, or surgery is done unwarrantedly. And all this proves to be very costly to the patient. So you must always understand that compliance has to be assessed on a regular basis. There are certain tricks to assess it. Most important thing is finding out the endpoints of your assessment. That is, on follow-up, look at the visual field, look at the disc damage, and check the IOP. So solutions to the non-compliance, you have to relate to the patients. So how do you do that? You always put yourself in the patient's shoes. If he's a heavy machinery worker, he will not use the morning drops. He will prefer to use the drops at night. He will not apply the morning medication. He will say that, no, I'll apply only the night medication. Because in the morning, if he applies brimonidine, for example, he go to sleep while working. So always see whether they are able to follow your instructions. Always use the most effective first-time therapy. So if he cannot use something in the morning, better to give something at night once a day, which will make him very happy. And you can use a prostaglandin for that. Always think that you should give the medication with the least adverse effect. There should be very few changes to be made on follow-up visits. So every time you change the medicine, patient will get confused. He'll come with the bottle and tell you that I have not applied the medicine mainly because I think you're going to change it. Or he'll come after the 2-3 days of non-applying the medicine because he'll say that medicine got over 4 days back. I know you're going to change it. And then it will be something like a blame game. He blames you, you blame him, and leads to a lot of acrimony. And always try to see if you can give the least number of medication. Now, least number of medication, from our perspective, doesn't mean that very few medication. It actually means number of bottles. So if you can give a set of 4 medication in 2 bottles, that also makes a lot of benefit for the patient, because he thinks the medication is not in numbers, but the number of bottles he's using. So such combination also you can use. So coming to the medical approaches to lowering IOP, we all know that you have the aqueous humor formation, which can affect the IOP, and then your uvuloscular outflow and the trabecular meshwork outflow. Now, medications are classified as per whether they inhibit aqueous humor formation or enhance outflow, either through trabecular meshwork or uvuloscular outflow. This is a slightly older slide. Here you will also get ROCK inhibitors. So classification of, coming to medication classification, you have the cholinergic agents, adrenergic agents, beta adrenergic antagonists, beta blockers, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, prostaglandin analog, ROCK inhibitors, hyperosmotic agents. And then we'll touch slightly upon mitomycin C, which is also a medication used for surgery, just as a, for surgery. So cholinergic agonist, most common, which we are familiar with, is pilocarpine, which is a direct acting cholinergic agent. The others we are not using, especially indirect acting, were used long time back. We are not using it. So the mechanism action is increasing the conventional output, that is by the contraction of the longitudinal muscle of the ciliary body pulling at the scleral spur. It opens the trabecular meshwork, and unfortunately, it also reduces the uvioscleral outflow. So what we are talking about is weak myotics, that is pilocarpine, because it mimics the drug that binds to the receptor site. It's direct acting acetylcholine mimicking drug that binds to the receptor site. Strong myotics, that is the indirect acting anticholinesterase enzyme inhibitors. We are not using that, ecothiophate and dimecorium for the old ones. Drug delivery systems were developed for these medications because they had to be applied almost 4 times a day. So a lot of drug delivery systems were developed. The most common one, which was we are familiar with, is the Ocucert. We have not used it personally, but it was there till 2000, 2003. It used to be used. And pilocarpine gel was available in India, something called low-carb gel. And that was available. It used to be applied 2 or 3 times a day just to make the medication stay in the eye for a long period of time. So where can these be used? They can be used in most forms of open angle glaucoma, but they should not be used in inflamed eyes, mainly because they increase the breakage of the blood aqueous barrier and they promote inflammation, anti-uveitis. So if you use it in inflamed eyes, you'll get rebound inflammation. So acute angle closure glaucoma, after the intraocular pressure is reduced, they are supposed to be the drug of choice. And congenital glaucoma, initially they don't respond, but after trabeculectomy, we have been using them with varying amounts of success. Glaucoma with angle recession, again, they have not much of a role. And malignant glaucoma, they're definitely contraindicated because they cause the lens iris diaphragm to come forward and worsen the malignant glaucoma. So these are the indications for cholinergic agents. Adverse effects are very important because only if you know the adverse effect, you can use the medication. Also, I like to just mention here that adverse effects of all the medication can be used to assess compliance. So if you know the adverse effects, you can assess compliance indirectly. So generally, you have general weakness, fatigue, diaphoresis. Patients will have sweating and salivation. These are all part of the parasympathomimetic actions. Bronchospasm, pulmonary edema, hypotension, bradycardia, diarrhea, vomiting, and cramps. And nowadays we are not using succinylcholine, but if you have a situation where the anesthetist uses succinylcholine, you have to inform him that this patient is on pilocarpine. Locally in the eye, you have eye ache, brow ache, meiosis, accommodative spasm, induced myopia. So this is something very troublesome to young patients. There is high chance of retinal detachment because this longitudinal muscle of the ciliary body is it's attached and very close to the aura, and because of that, there is a high chance of retinal detachment. When you're talking about retinal detachment in a patient with pilocarpine, once the patient comes back to you after usage of pilocarpine, don't think that the pilocarpine is working. Don't assume that. Please dilate the patients and check the periphery of the retina. He may be having a co-existing retinal detachment, which is actually contributing to a lower IOP than the pilocarpine itself. So patients with pilocarpine, you must always do at least once in a year dilated fundus examination to rule out peripheral breaks and detachment. Blood aqueous area breakdown, you have to think of this, especially in uveitic eyes. You must not use this for the inflammation. Cataract, you can get an iris cyst of the iris pigment epithelium, cicatrical pemphigoid, increased tear production, punctal stenosis, reduced uvioscleral outflow, as I mentioned, and progressively shallow chamber. So patient who is phakic and on pilocarpine, you must always assess the anti-chamber depth regularly. Even if necessary, you use a IOL master to quantify the anti-chamber depth, because they cause loosening of the zonules, they cause the ciliary muscle to be relaxed and pushes forward the lens iris diaphragm. If you think that you have started in an open angle glaucoma, and you think that this is going to be for a very long time, you must be careful that you may induce an angle closure glaucoma in these eyes. So be very careful when you're using pilocarpine for a very long period of time. Now the systemic problems which are there, they can all be addressed if you teach the patient punctal occlusion. So systemic absorption is what causes. Now, when you have a systemic absorption, these medications don't undergo the first pass effect. I hope you know what is the first pass effect. They're not metabolized by the liver. They get absorbed, and from the nasal, they don't get ingested. They from the nasal mucosa absorbs them very well, and they go straight to the lungs from to the right side of heart, and from there they go to the lungs. So what happens? They don't undergo first pass metabolism, so to say. Because of that, their side effect profile is quite high, and because of which, if you teach them punctal occlusion, absorptions reduce, and you can almost reduce the systemic complications by 50%. Now, coming to the dosage, the pilocarpine has short duration of effect. 2% is available in India, but abroad you have 4% and 6% also. You have pilocarpine with timolol combination in India. Ideally, it should be applied 3-4 times a day, but in India, we apply 3 times a day. And if you're applying 3 times a day, early morning dosage should be applied as soon as the patient wakes up. So that is something which you have to remember. Coming to adrenergic agonist, so we have the non-selective and epinephrine, and the dipyrephrine is the modified molecule of it. And then you have the selective alpha-2 agonist, which is clonidine, apraclonidine, and brimonidine. We are not very familiar with the usage of clonidine, but apraclonidine was available since till 2005, iopidine, but now then it has been stopped, and brimonidine is what is available. Epinephrine is epinephrine, which has a prodrug. So the moment it falls on the eye, it sort of disintegrates, and you get the active molecule on the surface of the eye. So mechanism action is complex. It affects both inflow and outflow. Application is that it can be used in all forms of glaucoma. IOP should be assessed after several weeks after initiating therapy, because it takes a long time for the full peak action to occur. It should be avoided in FA kick, especially adrenaline, because of reversible CME. Narrow angles also, they cause slight mydriasis, because of which narrow angles, if you have not done gonioscopy, please avoid using this medication initially. Dipyrephrine, because of the prodrug, it has zero systemic side effects. Apraclonidine reaches the blood-brain barrier very poorly, but it has very high ocular allergy and tachyphylaxis. So apraclonidine was not used for a long period of time. It was only used for certain special indications, like blunting the IOP spike after lasers, especially YAG laser capsulotomy or YAG laser iridotomy. Brimonidine has been now replacing that, and it's also very suitable for long period of time. Tachyphylaxis with apraclonidine was quite common. 0.5% used to be used for a long time. 1% was used for as blunting the IOP spike after laser procedures. Adverse effects of epinephrine include headache and nervousness, hypertension, tachycardia, arrhythmias. In the eye, they can cause blurring of vision, burning, tearing sensation, follicular conjunctival reaction, CME, as I mentioned, endothelial toxicity, mydriasis. So in angle closure eyes or in patients on epinephrine or brimonidine, please do regular gonioscopic evaluation in phakic eyes, cicatrical pemphigoid and adrenochrome deposits. In brimonidine, lethargy is very, very important. So I was giving you an example of a patient who has driving heavy machinery. So be careful when you prescribe, or if the patient himself is a caretaker, himself or herself is a caretaker for another patient, you may not want to give brimonidine, because they'll be sleeping the whole day. They won't be able to take care of themselves nor of the other person whom they're taking care of. So all these are special occupational conditions in which, through personal experience, we have found that better to avoid brimonidine. Fatigue, drowsiness, dry mouth of the mouth and nose is also there. You can have reduced BP, vasovagal syncope, follicular reaction. Follicular conjunctivitis reaction is very severe. It can occur anytime. There is no, dose to reaction correlation. For many years, the patient may be using it, and all of a sudden, they may develop a follicular conjunctivitis. Liver extraction and mydriasis, contraindicated MAO inhibitors. Patients taking MAO inhibitors. Coming to beta blockers, propranolol was the first beta blocker which was studied extensively. It was even used for the eye. But because of severe systemic effects, it was not popularized. But timolol was found to have good IOP lowering efficacy, discovered in 1978. It reduces aqueous production by almost one third. onset of action is 2 hours and duration lasts for 24 hours. It can be used for all forms of glaucoma, inflammatory, non-inflammatory. And the non-selective agents are timolol, cardiolol, levobunolol, metoprolol. Beta-1 cardioselective is betoxolol. Adverse effects include depression, confusion, nightmare, psychosis, bronchospasm, serious in cardiovascular system. You have bradycardia, hypotension, myocardial contractility reduced. Congestive cardiac failure can be precipitated in patients who are compensated for some reason. And then you start the medication, they can become decompensated. So CCF is per se is not a contraindication, but a patient who is compensated can be pushed into a state of decompensation in congestive cardiac failure. In heart blocks, definite contraindication. And GIT, you have nausea, diarrhea, and myasthenia gravis, you are not supposed to use it. And it causes masking of the hypoglycemic symptoms. So this is something which is very important. We face this regularly in our clinics. Patients who have retina as well as glaucoma problems, they come and wait in the morning for visual field as well as angiography. And you know, since they have to come fasting, somehow it gets delayed, process gets delayed, and then they have a fainting episode. So this is, we don't, because they're on glaucoma medication, we're not able to identify, or the patient themselves are not able to identify such a situation. So masking of the hypoglycemic symptoms is very common. And all these side effects can be reduced if you just teach the patient how to compress the canalicular by doing functal occlusion. Even gentle closing of the eyelids is sufficient to reduce the absorption of the medication into the bloodstream. As I mentioned, these medications don't undergo the first pass effect on the by the liver. So ocular effects include burning hyperemia, corneal anesthesia, intraocular inflammation is induced by metoprolol, cicatrical pemphigoid, allergic conjunctivitis. Coming to carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, you have the oral parenteral ones, aspazolamide, methoxazolamide. Topical ones are dorzolamide and brinzolamide, which is very easily available here. So the mechanism of action is that carbonic anhydrase inhibitor inhibits the carbonic anhydrase enzyme. There are three types. The type 1 and 2 is present in corneal endothelium, type 2 and 4 in the ciliary body. And this enzyme catalyzes the reversible reaction of CO2 to H2CO3. The bicarbonate is then coupled to the secretion of sodium, which drags fluid along with it to form the aqueous humor. The peak action is in 2 hours, used in all forms of glaucoma. You can have injectable, which is available abroad, but not here, aspazolamide. Methoxazolamide is also available as tablets. Adverse effects of the aspazolamide: general paresthesia, metallic taste, headache, malaise. In central nervous system, you have depression, also libido, respiratory system, you have respiratory decompensation patients with COPD. Cardiovascular system, you have decreased blood pressure. GI systems, you have cramps and nausea. Renal, you have nephrolithiasis, renal failure. Hematologic complications are, you should know. As of now, we have not had a situation, but it can induce aplastic anemia, agranulocytosis, thrombocytopenia. Hypokalemia and metabolic acidosis go hand in hand, and in patients, in such patients, you should be very careful in avoid giving these medications actually. Topically, they have a metallic taste when it gets into the mouth and nasopharynx. They have stinging sensation mainly because of the pH value. For example, dorzolamide, the normal pH is 6.7. And brinzolamide doesn't have that stinging sensation, but it comes in a suspension form. Foreign body sensation, blurred vision. Brinzolamide has been shown to cause severe blurred vision. And one of the studies have mentioned that the blurred vision goes off in 5 minutes time. So if you ask the patient to close the eyelids for 5 minutes, they will not appreciate this blurring of vision. Corneal decompensation is there mainly because of the fact that it also inhibits the carbonic anhydrase enzyme 1 and 2 in the corneal endothelium and cataract formation. Coming to prostaglandin analogs, high concentration of prostaglandin analogs were shown to cause hyperemia, breakdown of blood aqueous barrier, meiosis, and raised intraocular pressure. When they reduce the concentration to what we call is the homeopathic doses, 0.003, 0.004, low concentration, it reduces it reduces the intraocular pressure without associated inflammation. So the available prostaglandins with us are the bimetoprost, travoprost, latoprost, and tafluprost. Unioprostone is not available. So tafluprost has been recently launched by the parent company which discovered it, that is Santen. I don't have any financial disclosure here. Why it became very popular was because of the lack of tachyphylaxis. It was very effective, very can be added to any of the other combinations. You have once a day therapy, which is very advantageous, very few serious side effects. And the mechanism of action was novel. It would increase the uveoscular outflow through the ciliary body phase. That means gonioscopically, this eye should have at least open angles. So if you are treating with the angle closure, you will get some response, but the ciliary body phase, if it is visible, it's better to treat these patients after PI rather than doing without a PI. Latanoprost is metabolized in the liver and the half-life is 17 minutes. So it's very rapidly metabolized. Applications, again, all forms of primary open angle glaucoma, primary angle closure glaucoma after laser peripheralectomy, and secondary open angle glaucoma, not useful in inflammatory glaucomas, especially with glaucoma with viral keratitis, keratouveitis, neovascular glaucoma, uveitic glaucoma. In patients with aphakia and with pseudophakia with pacey dehiscence, we can have a CME in these eyes. So they are predisposed to CME, so better to avoid prostaglandin in such eyes. Adverse effects, systemically, there are almost no adverse effects. Some reports suggest that they may have gastrointestinal prokinetic effects like diarrhea and all, but almost all the literature says that they have very minimal systemic side effects. Ocular, you have numerous side effects. So conjunctival hyperemia, which is reversible, occurs in 47 to 69% of patients. SPKs can occur and also can occur reactivation of herpes simplex keratitis. Iris pigmentation becomes irreversible, especially if the color of the iris is hazel. In 33% of eyes, you can get a hazel. And this occurs within the first 3 months. If it has not occurred 3 years after treatment, then it will not occur. So that is something which you have to remember. The cause is increased melanin pigmentation, but no change in the melanocyte proliferation. Eyelash growth is reversible. You have a thickness is increased, length is increased, and so is the pigmentation. And something you have to know is PAP, that is prostaglandin associated periorbitopathy. One is skin darkening. The other one is reabsorption of retroorbital fat. So if you have patients who are on prostaglandin, the incidence of developing skin darkening doesn't happen immediately, but it happens over a period of time. The incidence is 1.5 to 2.9% of the patients who are under your care. Less than 3% may develop skin darkening. So this is one article which I would recommend that all of you read. Intraocular pressure lowering effects of all commonly used glaucoma medication. So now, so far, we have been talking about percentage point of IOP reduction, but it's also important to understand how much to pressure reduce in absolute value. So prostaglandin from all the clinical trials have been shown to reduce IOP by 8.4 millimeters of mercury. Non-selective beta blocker, that is timolol, reduces IOP by about 7 millimeters of mercury. Alpha adrenergics, that is brimonidine, reduces IOP by about 6 millimeters of mercury. And topical CAI also reduces IOP by 5.9 millimeters of mercury. And this is a simple table to just show you what is the onset of action of all the medication, what is the peak and what is the duration. So alpha agonist onset occurs, aqueous secretion is reduced within 1 to 2 hours, but trabecular flow outflow is increased, 4 to 6 hours it takes, peak onset. And duration lasts for about 12 hours. If you want the medicine to be washed out, you have to give at least 3 week washout period. Beta blockers reduce aqueous secretion within 2 hours, they start acting. Peak is achieved in 2 to 3 hours and it lasts for about 12 hours. Washout is about 4 hours, 4 to 5 weeks. Carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, the aqueous secretion reduced. You get the peak effect within 2 hours, onset within 2 hours, peak in about 8 hours. And then the washout is about 5 to 7 days. Cholinergic, they increase the trabecular outflow within 1 hour, and then the peak is at You get peak effect at 7 hours after application, and washout is the shortest, that is about 3 days. And prostaglandin, you get the onset of action within, that is increased urovascular outflow within 4 hours. The peak takes long time to come, almost 12 hours. And they last for 24 hours. The effect lasts for 24 hours. The washout is about 6 weeks. So if you want the medicine to be washed out of your body, you have to give a time period of 6 weeks. This is again the local and systemic effects of topically applied medication. You can put this in your clinic and you know you can refer to it quickly as you are seeing the patients. So coming to hyperosmotic agents, you have mannitol and glycerol is what we are familiar with. Mannitol and glycerol, isosorbide, ascorbic acid, urea, we are not using very much. But this is the concentration, 5 to 20% mannitol, 2 gram per kg is the dosage in IV route. 50% is concentration of oral glycerol, 1.5 gram per kg, you give it as in the oral route. Isosorbide and urea, again, are oral and IV respectively. The main issue is that you get only a temporary drop in IOP. So if you want a temporary drop, you want to see clearly through the media, you want the corneal edema to reduce, you can use it, or you want to use it as a pain relief. You have to administer it rapidly using a wide bore cannula, and patient should not be given fluids later. Very limited value in inflammatory glaucomas, mainly because of the breakage in the blood aqueous barrier. You can have the molecules go into the vitreous cavity and cause a rebound inflammation. Rebound raised intraocular pressure after some time. So just give it once, don't repeat it. Adverse effects are you can induce a cardiovascular overloading of the system, you can induce congestive cardiac failure, and renal disease, it's really contraindicated because they may not be able to excrete so much of a fluid. You can induce urinary retention susceptible patients. And in very elderly people, you can induce a subdural hematoma, especially very old, frail patients, we can induce a subdural hematoma. Coming to antifibrotic agents, mitomycin C is from Streptococcus thespitosus. It's better if you see your OT staff doing it. How we use it is mitomycin C is soaked sponges are used 0.02% for 2 minutes. Otherwise, injections of 20 microgram, 40 microgram, 5 minutes before surgery is also nowadays people are practicing that. Just to touch upon 5-fluorouracil is a pyrimidine analog, cytotoxic effect on rapidly multiplying cells. It mimics uracil, so disrupts pyrimidine synthesis in S phase. You can use it. It comes as a ready to use vial. 25 milligram per ml, you get a 50 milligram per ml, you get a 10 cc vial. You just draw 1 cc and you use the sponge to dip it in that and use it directly. You can also give it subconjunctively post-operatively to enhance the function. That is 5 milligram in 0.1 ml, daily injection 7 to 14 days, just around the bleb or opposite direction of the bleb. So having covered so far, the moment you see a patient, you have to categorize your patient into groups. So once you do that, you will know that what sort of methodology to use, what medications to use, what is your target IOP to achieve, what is your treatment target. So for example, I've just made some scenarios here. You have, this is given by the European Glaucoma Society guidelines. You have a group one, a patient who has glaucoma at very high risk. So you need to achieve a target pressure reduction of at least 30% or close to an episcleral venous pressure, that is 7 to 20 millimeters of mercury, if safely achievable. In group two, you have a patient who has glaucoma who is moderate risk or a glaucoma suspect who is high risk. So you reduce the intraocular pressure by 20%. Group three is a moderate risk of visual field loss from glaucoma. So monitor closely for change. If the risk increases, for example, he does a pseudo exfoliation or he has to take steroids for asthma, then you try to achieve target IOP reduction of 20%. Low risk of visual loss from glaucoma is the fourth category. Just monitor. There is no active treatment for these patients. So patients who are in group one, who have definitive glaucomatous optic neuropathy with correlating visual field, For example, this individual, he has got a 46-year-old male open angle presenting IOP of 26. This is a visual field, 10-2. You can see it's minus 12 in the right eye and minus 8 in the left eye. And his occupation is the tailor. So you have to reduce the intraocular pressure by at least 50%. You have to bring it down to low teens. So 50% is 13 millimeters of mercury. So you start off with, start low and slow. You can start off with a prostaglandin analog. But once he reduces, the intraocular pressure reduces, then you can add the next medication. So a combination of prostaglandin analog and a beta blocker will be helpful, but in a stepwise manner. Don't add both together, because invariably what will happen, one will finish earlier than the other. He will delay coming back to you. He'll use only one, and then he'll continue to go. He'll continue to go worsening. So start one. Make sure he knows you achieve something, but it's not sufficient. And then you add the next medication. So category two is patients who have moderate risk of visual loss from glaucoma, suspect with high risk of visual field loss. Mild glaucoma is optic neuropathy correlating with early field loss. Mild to moderate normal pressure glaucoma, ocular hypertensives, primary angle closure with high IOP or fast angle neovascularization. So this is the individual lady. She's 41 years of age. She's got a first degree AV block. She's a housewife by occupation. So visual field is, the right is okay. Left has got a nasal depression, you can see here, and also got a RNFL defect, you can see here. So you have to slightly, you don't need to have bring down to 50% IOP lowering, because our baseline IOP is 23. So you can just reduce it by about 20%. So you can manage with a monotherapy. For example, the carbonic anhydrase inhibitor or alpha agonist can be used depending on the patient preference as well as discussion with the patient. So group three, just to give you an example, this suspect, fellow eyes of established glaucoma, optic neuro atrophy actually, and ocular hypertensives with suspicious disc, low central corneal thickness. So this individual is a 52-year-old male who's got open angles, presenting IOP is 18. He's bronchial asthma patient on steroids. So the physician has asked him to take steroids as and when he wants it. So we cannot interfere in that. No RNFL defect as such, and visual fields are equivocal. So you could reduce the intraocular pressure by about 20%. So you could bring it down to 14, 15. So that's not actually 50% or even 20%. There's something just about 15 to 20%. And you can do that easily with a monotherapy, because prostaglandins, because you know prostaglandins can also reduce intraocular pressure within the normal range. So this is something sufficient for this individual patient. Treatment category four is patients with low risk of visual field loss from glaucoma. So ocular hypertensive patients presenting with cupping in the old age, occludable angles, pigment dispersion syndrome, who really don't have any strong signs of glaucoma, but has suspicious discs. And patients who are steroid responder or user, myopia. So this individual is a 23-year-old male, myope, open angles. The only issue is he's got a family history of glaucoma in the grandfather. So his fields are good. He's got large discs. And we're just monitoring for developmental, structural or functional defects. So that's how you can categorize your patients. So before we start off with the newer glaucoma medication, I'll stop sharing my screen. If you have any questions, we'll take a 10-second break. If you have any questions, we can address it here. Madhuri, any questions? Pondicherry.
No question, sir.
Okay, thank you. Coimbatore, I think there's another team upstairs.
No question, sir.
Okay, we'll continue. I'll share my screen again. Any other center, any questions?
Sir, this is from Pondicherry. Yeah. I just wanted to know role of prostaglandins in neovascular glaucoma, sir. Like many a times, patients are already on maximum medical therapy and IOP is still in range of 20s, 30s, where we may not consider diode CPC. So can we consider giving prostaglandins in such patients?
Yeah, the straight answer to that is actually no. Because it will increase the inflammation and the patients will become very uncomfortable. So this is particular to neovascular glaucoma, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So neovascular glaucoma, the issue is ongoing inflammation in the eye. So these patients have something called irritative iridocyclitis. So in the morning itself, they'll know whether the eye is going to be very irritating today or not. So in such situations, what you could do is, what I do actually is once I get this information from them, I tell them that you can use your steroids. You can titrate using your steroids. So if they have severe pain, they can use it 6 to 8 times a day. If they have less inflammation, they can use it once or twice a day. So every day is going to be different for them. And this is where the cost factor in managing these patients with respect to, you know, the cost of treatment comes into play. Because I mentioned in the beginning of the slide that cost containment is one of the important goals which have been set by the European government. It was not there in the last guidelines, but this guidelines, it has been added on because we have to use more expensive medication for control of these for these conditions. So cost containment reflects that you do something palliatively for these eyes, wherever you can. So coming back to your question, you can use this steroid. And now the main concern with using steroids is they can cause in susceptible patients or in eyes which have severe IOP rise and they have corneal bullae, they can get infected. Isn't it so?
Yes.
So once they get infected, then the infection doesn't go away because they get nourishment from the aqueous. So they get, and then the glaucoma surgeons are not able to do anything because in infected situation. So we cannot take them to OR or do a diode CPC or something for that. So to avoid this, what I suggest to the patient is to apply an ointment of either ciprofloxacin or some ofloxacin at night. So as to prevent this inflammation. And as soon as possible, it is always better to do a diode cyclophotocoagulation for these eyes if they have no real visual benefit. And keep these eyes very quiescent as much as possible. Now, having said that, there are certain situations in which patients are affordable. And sometimes in very rare situations, we use bimetoprost, mainly because it has much better scleral penetration than other prostaglandins. So very rare, so if you are covering it with good steroid cover, then that inflammation component is not very much visible, but you get the IOP lowering benefits of in such eyes, all the medications which you give do not penetrate into the cornea. The cornea is so edematous, it's so unhealthy and full of fluid that medication penetration is totally not there. So how do you expect any of the anti-glaucoma medications to work? So these eyes have to be treated in a more aggressive and either laser or surgical manner just to prevent, just to reduce their costs, number one. Number two, keep the eyes quiet so that they don't continue to spend so much money on them. Any other question from any other center? This is a very ongoing debate whether to use prostaglandin in neovascular glaucoma. It's a good question. Thank you for asking it. If not, I'll continue with my slide share. Am I, are the slides visible? Am I audible?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
So, newer glaucoma medications, number one is Netarsudil, then Latonoprostin, Bunod, Trebodenison, and D117, which is Omidenipag, which we were part of it in the clinical trial. So these are some of the newer medications which are going to come. In fact, the Latonoprostin Bunod is known as Vysulta. It is already Vysulta. It's already available. And Netarsudil is again available in the US, either as an individual form or as a fixed dose therapy with Latonoprost. So, Vysulta is Latonoprostin Bunod. It is a nitric oxide donating PG analog, has a dual mechanism action. So, it is a prostaglandin, but also it donates a nitric oxide moiety, which increases both the uveal sclerosis as well as the trabecular meshwork outflow. It's not yet available in India, and it's approved for use by the US FDA from 2017 onwards. We come to RHO inhibitors, ROCK inhibitors, RHO kinase inhibitors. You have a triple action mechanism. It reduces aqueous production, increases the trabecular meshwork outflow, and reduces epistolar venous pressure. And all these studies are actually over. Now it's all phase 3 trials are also over. And it can be, it's known as ROPRESA in the US. We have something called Riparsudil, which is the first RHO kinase inhibitor to be discovered in the Japan. And then now it's available. Ajanta Pharma is the company which markets it, known as Ripartek in India. Again, no financial interest in these products. And they can be combined with Latonoprost, so that is known as Roflatan. So from 2017 December onwards, these are all actually available in the US. Now we also have Riparsudil. It was approved for use in Japan 2014, and it's available as 0.4% BID dosage. The IOP lowering effect was actually quite low, 2 to 4.4. That's why it has not picked up in the Indian scenario, because we need higher IOP lowering capabilities of the medication, because our glaucoma patients present with high IOP, whereas Japanese patients present with normal pressure glaucoma. So there's some difference. And the main issue was they have a dose-dependent transient congenital hyperemia. That was the main side effect for this medication. ROCK inhibitors, that is RHO kinase inhibitors, they relax the trabecular meshwork tissue, reduce secretion of extracellular matrix to increase outflow and reduce the intraocular pressure. So these are the mechanism of action by inhibition, RHO kinase inhibition. Netarsudil relaxes the trabecular meshwork and increases outflow, and it also lowers the epistolar venous pressure, and it also Netarsudil also reduces the fluid production. So all these activities occur in the trabecular meshwork area. And once you combine it with Latonoprost, so you also have the advantage of increasing the uvascular outflow and also enhancing the trabecular meshwork outflow. That is the rationale for using ROCK inhibitors along with prostaglandins. So these studies are known as the ROCKET studies, ROCKET 1, 2, 3, and 4. And they compared it with the Latonoprost and Timolol, twice daily dosing with once daily. And most of the response was obtained at IOPs of less than 27, 25 millimeters per mercury. So if you go to very high IOP levels, these medications don't seem to work very well. So in those eyes, we still need to have Timolol and prostaglandin as our mainstay. But if you are treating somebody who is in the range of less than 25 millimeters of mercury, then these medications do pretty well. So like I said, Roflatan is the combination of Netarsudil and Latonoprost. Again, as I mentioned, it also has the advantage of increasing the uvascular outflow. And this group of studies are known as the Mercury trials. And they compared the fixed dose combination with the individual combinations. And they found that the fixed dose combination was more efficacious than individual components. by about 1 to 3 millimeters of mercury. So that was the results of these trials. Omidinipag, isopropyl D117 was, we were part of it. Our center, Aravind Eye Hospital Coimbatore, was part of the study. This was study done in 4 Asian countries. That was in Taiwan, South Korea, and Singapore and India. So there were almost 27 centers in India. We were one of the centers. And the mechanism of action is that it increased the outflow of aqueous humor via the neurovascular outflow and trabecular outflow pathways, resulting in potent and stable reduction in intraocular pressure. Approved for treatment in Japan since 2018. And its dosage is 0.002%, 1 drop HS. We have used this. It was very nice and very less side effects as compared to in the prostaglandin. Then there was a small study in which they tried this against people who did not respond very well to latanoprost. In them also, you can get almost a 3 millimeter IOP drop from baseline. That is, you start them on prostaglandin and then you add this, you still get additional thing. That's very rare to get such a thing without using a beta blocker. So this medication has shown that this is possible. Trabordinison is an adenosine mimetic. It acts as A1 receptor in the trabecular meshwork. And it improves the metabolic activity, upregulates the protease that remove the protein deposition which cause the trabecular meshwork. 3 doses are available, 3%, 1000 microgram, 4.5%, 1500 microgram BD, and 6%, 2000 microgram once a day. So the phase 3 trials failed. And but they have the Matrix 1 trial in which they included 303 patients with primary open angle and ocular hypertension. That is ongoing. Drug delivery systems are novel. So what is available now is, we can see in a lot of the webinars, is the bimetoprost SR and the bimetoprost ocular insert and the intracanalicular depot travoprost, OTXTP. So briefly, there are numerous drug delivery mechanisms. You have the bimetoprost ring, which we are going to see now, and then the gel forming drops, ophthalmic micropump, intracameral implants, and injectable drugs.
Sir, you are not audible, sir.
Now? Is it better now?
No, sir.
Now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And the punctal plugs, OTXTP. So these are all the... So you have the bimetoprost ocular insert is a ring about 24 to 29 millimeters in diameter, and then you insert it into the fornix of the eye, and you just see a small whitish structure there that indicates that the ring is in place. So you just insert in the fornix and it remains there, and then it slowly releases the active ingredient, and you have a absorption through the sclera and the conjunctiva. Coming to the injector, bimetoprost SR, you have a small device like this, which is biodegradable implant, something like the Ozurdex, which you are familiar with. The same company is developing this, and they have inserted it into the eye, and it remains there in the anterior chamber for a period of 6 months. So if you see, this is the dosage BD of the medication, and this is the implant. So number of eyes are totally almost same in the BID dosage and the implant. And you find that the intraocular pressure reduction is also not so bad. And OTXTP is an intracanalicular depot, travoprost, punctal plug. So it's a rod-shaped polyethylene glycol-based hydrogel implant encapsulating the active drug. It's placed in the vertical portion of the superior inferior canaliculi. The violet coloration helps to identify the blue light in the blue light filter in the slit lamp. And the IOP reduction occurs about 24% on day 10 and 15.6% day 30. So every month you can place an implant and that will slowly release the medication, and then you can have the absorption. So I'll stop here. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to. I'll keep the slide share on. Thank you for patient listening. Pondicherry, any questions?
There are no questions from Pondicherry, sir.
Other any questions?
No questions, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Coimbatore?
No questions, sir.
Thank you. Tirunelveli, any questions? Tirunelveli, any questions?
No questions, sir.
Okay, thank you for patiently.
Thank you very much, sir, for this comprehensive lecture. So, if there are no further questions, we can close the session.
Thank you.